haven't met, my name is Kyle. I get to serve as one of our pastors here. And I want to say welcome to all of you that are joining us online and to the ladies at God Behind Bars. We love you. We're glad that you are here as well. And if you are new with us today, we would love nothing more than to be able to meet you. We have a couple ways that we can do that. One is by you just texting the word new to 615-615. It's a way for us to just send you some information about CrossPoint and the mission that we are on to help you find and follow Jesus. And then if you're in the room this morning, we would love to meet you here while you're here as well. And so you can make your way out to the Info Center right after the service. We have some amazing volunteers out there that would love to give you a free gift just to say welcome and to give you more information about how you can get plugged in if you feel like this is a church for you. And then also, if you're new, I want to invite you. Every Tuesday here at the Nashville campus, we do prayer. Prayer is for everyone. We're praying for revival in the city. We're praying for renewal in the church and an awakening across Middle Tennessee. And we just want to encourage you to be here every Tuesday at 11 o'clock right here in this room. You can join us. And as we get to pray and we get to worship together. And worship is where we're going to start this morning. And so if you are able, go ahead and stand to your feet. And I just want to encourage you. Pastor Kevin said it a couple weeks ago. He said, the enemy doesn't know what to do when we worship in the valley. And so whatever you're coming in with this morning, maybe you're having a valley moment. Maybe you are on a mountaintop this morning. Let's rejoice always in the name of the Lord. Let's rejoice in here with everything you have this morning as the team comes to lead us in worship. Let's praise the Lord, everybody.
Rejoice in the Lord, and again I say, rejoice in the Lord, and again I say, come on, let's sing. Rejoice in the Lord, and again I say, rejoice in the Lord, and again I say, always singing praise to the Lord, for He alone is good, and His love will endure forever and always, always, always. Hey.
Sing again, rejoice in the Lord.
Rejoice in the Lord, and again I say, rejoice in the Lord, and again I say, always singing praise to the Lord. He alone is good, and His love will endure forever and always.
Singing praise,
singing praise
to the Lord.
Yeah. He alone is good, and His love in my lungs. That's why I praise the Lord. Made His mercy rise with the sun. That's why,
yeah,
I praise the Lord. Gives me blessings. How can I count?
You say
that's why, yeah, I praise.
And the Lord is working everything out. That's why.
Aren't you thankful he's always good? Aren't you thankful? Somebody told me one time he never wakes up in a bad mood. I don't know about you, but I'm thankful to serve a God who is consistent with his goodness, his faithfulness, and his holiness. So we are invited into worship as a response today, church, for all that he is. Would you sing with us? Come on, church.
A thousand generations falling down in worship to sing the song of ages to the Lamb. And all who've gone before us and all who will believe will sing the song of ages to the Lamb. Your name is the highest, your name is the greatest, your name stands above them all thrones and dominions, all power and position.
Creation cry. Holy.
know that you're here with us because the Bible tells us that you inhabit the praises of your people. So we acknowledge you now, Spirit of God. You are worthy of all praise. You are worthy of our worship. Jesus at the center, it's all about you. It's always been you. From one generation to the next, we'll sing. So, Father, we ask that you receive our praise today. Let it be a delight to you. I pray that you sense the aroma in this place and that it be pleasing to you. This is your house and we are your people. Let your will be done and your kingdom come, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you for worshiping with us, church. You can have a seat.
Hey everybody, I'm Ashley and welcome to this month's edition of the Dollar Club, our opportunity to give just one extra dollar and see the amazing things that can happen when we all do good together. This month we're sitting down with Jenny, who after raising her own children has welcomed another little girl into her home. Jenny, thank you so much for sitting down and talking to us today. Tell me a little bit about Vandy.
Vandy is four. She just turned four last week. She is smart. She's fun. She is a survivor. She is full of life. And if she loves you, like she loves you big.
So you said that Vandy was a survivor when she came to you. How did she come into your life?
My first cousin, Susie, is about 15 years older than me. And we have been close our whole life. She's more like a sister than a cousin. Her son, Ryan, is Vandy's biological father. August of 2021, Susie sent me a text message and had a news article clipped to it that said, man overdosed with toddler by his side. And she said, it's Ryan. I will never forget these big, giant blue eyes. And I just said, well, Vandy, I'm Jenny, and put her in my arms. And we got her in the car seat, and we left Pulaski.
She's really about, what, 18 months at this point?
She was 16, almost 16 months old. We just kind of settled into, okay, now what do we do? I had one in college and one in high school, driving, 16.
And so then it's been taking a in a one-and-a-half-year-old.
It was difficult in the sense of balancing schedules and really helping her to feel safe.
Yeah.
You know, one of the first things she did at my house was go to the garbage can to try to get food out. I just pray a lot. I have a lot of prayer warriors, A lot of people that love this baby. And, you know, like I said, her birthday party, we had probably 30-something people there. And people that hear her story just and like I said to you in the beginning, I mean, you just meet her and you just want more of her.
With this being a private placement, how is that different from being a DCS placement?
If this were a DCS placement, she would have become a ward of the state.
Yeah.
So they would have picked her up at the overdose and made her and put her into the system. There's about 9,500 in Tennessee in foster care. So she would have been behind a lot of kids looking for a foster home. Because it's private, I incur the expenses.
Right, so attorney fees, everything.
Attorney fees, daycare, you know, diapers, wipes, doctor's appointments, counseling appointments, you know, feeding her, all of the things that you do with a child, right? I mean, you buy them new shoes, you do all those things. Daycare has been a huge expense. I have had lots of people step in and help in many, many ways. It's been wonderful to watch how God has worked through all of it and has touched other people's hearts.
What is your hope for Vandy and her future?
My hope for Vandy is that she stays in a forever home that will love her forever and support her and take her to college where she wants to go, that will go to her basketball games, that will help support her in sports, that will teach her about her past and her history. That will share her story and that will love her unconditionally like the love Christ loves us and teach her about what he has done in her life.
Well, I know that we said we wanted to share yours and Vandy's story, which we do, but we also at CrossPoint have this thing called the Dollar Club, where once a month we ask everybody in the church to throw in an extra dollar, pull that money together and find a need in the community that needs to be filled and go fill it. And so when we heard your and Vandy's story, we knew that we wanted to come alongside you. So we have a check today for you, just because the generosity of a whole lot of people, for $10,000.
Oh, my goodness. Oh, my goodness. Oh, my goodness. Thank you. Thank you to the people that did this. That's unbelievable. That's how he shows up.
Yeah.
That is unbelievable, but not surprising. Thank you so much.
Wow. You're so welcome.
I was not expecting that at all.
Well.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much. Life changing.
Isn't that awesome? I just know that God's looking down upon Jenny and just saying, well done, faithful servant. And here's what we know. Here in Middle Tennessee, there's over 1,800 children in the foster care system. And here's what we also know, that there's only about half of that number of foster families that are available for placement. So what we know is that we have a problem, but we also have an opportunity for us as the body of Christ to do something about it. And there's a couple things that you can start praying about how God would use you in this. One is that you would start praying about how you could become a foster care family right here in Middle Tennessee. Or maybe you haven't felt that calling, but maybe you just want to do something. We have ways that you can come alongside foster care families right here in Middle Tennessee as well. And so today, what I'd encourage you to do is just text the word foster to 615-615. This is a great way for us to be able to send you some information about what it looks like just to get involved, to be able to help with this problem, that it is an opportunity for us as a church to get involved and to help with this problem that we see in Middle Tennessee and be just like Jenny, how she just came alongside and just filled a need with the resources that she had available. So we'd encourage you to text the word foster to 615-615 today to be involved. And I just want to say thank you for the way that you guys continuously give. I want to invite our guest experience team forward now as we prepare to receive the offering. But I just want to thank you. And these Dollar Club stories are amazing as we get to see those together when we all just do a little bit. But it goes a really long way. And a portion of everything that you give here at CrossPoint goes right back out the door to helping other local partners, but to helping other needs right here in Middle Tennessee as well. So thank you for your generosity. And if you are new here today, there is no pressure for you to give. We're just simply glad that you're here, but we do want to invite you in on this mission that we're on to help people find and follow Jesus. All right. And without any further ado, we want to jump right into the last week of About Time with Pastor Kevin.
Time matters. It's the currency of life. Every second, every minute, every hour, every day, time shapes our experiences, defines our relationships, and reflects the very rhythm in which we engage life. We often look back at time wasted or misspent, leading us to guilt or regret. Scripture tells us the story of God who redeems. Our God is here today, ready and willing to restore our yesterdays and lead us into a hopeful tomorrow. Are you ready? It's about time.
Welcome to CrossPoint. So glad that you're here today. And before we jump into the teaching, I want to lead us in a moment of prayer. Can we just do that together? Father, we take a moment and we pause to remember who we're talking to. God of grace, God of forgiveness, God who is holy, who is just, God who loves us so much. Father, thank you that you love us so much that you would send your son. And Jesus, we thank you that you have made a way for us to be forgiven. You've made a way for us to have access to the Father. We thank you for the Spirit of God that's been poured into our hearts. So we pray that even now, that you would speak to us. We need to hear from you. So even now, would you just whisper a prayer to God and just ask him to speak to your heart? And Father, we pray that through your word, that you would speak into the places of our hearts and of our lives, of our relationships, of our past, and that you bring healing, that you bring grace, that you bring redemption. And Father, I pray that you would you give power to communicate this truth today, and that all of our lives would be changed because of your grace and your love and your mercy. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Well, excited to finish up this series. It's been a great series called About Time, and today to wrap up the series, we're going to talk about scars. That's where we're going to start, is talking about scars. And scars create a sort of timeline of our lives and of our stories. There's a country music singer, Cody Johnson, who has a song that scars. Every scar has a story. And so I was thinking, I want you to pick out a scar and tell the person next to you the story behind. No, we're not going to do that because I don't trust some of you with that moment. I really don't. And so we're going to hold that. I'll share a couple stories for all of us. One of them is this scar right here. I've got a scar on my finger from when I was 12 years old and I was whittling with my Cub Scout knife. And that's where I learned a lesson. I learned a lesson that you don't whittle like this, you whittle like this. And I think I've got another scar on the back of my head, and that was from when I was 12 years old. And I got a bike for my birthday that was where I learned that some bikes have coaster brakes and some bikes have freewheel. And so I kept going backwards. There was no brakes with the pedals, and so I went over the handlebars and hit my head on the curb, and that's had stitches, and so that's that scar. And then So I was thinking about that. I was like, you know, there are two ways to learn. There are two schools. There's a school of wisdom and the school of consequences. And the school of wisdom, you learn the lesson without having the consequences. And the school of consequences is you have to make the mistake to learn the lesson. And the school of consequences, tuition is greater than the school of wisdom. It costs more, and instead of diplomas, you get scars. And so that's the school of consequences. And then I was thinking, but sometimes we have scars that aren't because of anything that we did. It was because of something else that happened. I thought about a scar that I have on my shoulder from when I was 12. It was a rough year. 12 was a rough. It was a rough year. It's when I was 12, and I went to the dermatologist. And the dermatologist said that there's a problem with that birthmark. He said there was cancer in the birthmark, and so they had to take out the birthmark. And on the way, I was getting ready to check out of school to go have the procedure. And I told my teacher where I was going, and my literature teacher or English teacher in middle school, sixth grade, told me, you know, there's an Edgar Allan Poe short story about a man who had a birthmark and who went to get the birthmark removed. And the doctor kept digging and digging and digging and could not find the end of the birthmark. That's terrifying. Why would you tell a 12-year-old that story? I was like, that's horrible. I learned a lesson that day that people say stupid things. People say stupid things. And so this we have scars that tell a story, and some of them are on the outside of our bodies, and then we have other scars that are on the heart. And we're looking at the story of Jacob, and we're looking at the story of a man in the Old Testament who he had scars. He had wounds. He had wounds that happened in his lives. Some of them were because of decisions that he had made, and then sometimes those scars were because of decisions that were self-inflicted, and sometimes the scars, emotional scars that he had, were because of what other people did. And he had severed relationships. He had brokenness in his past. He had scars that told stories of things that he did, like when he swindled his brother out of his birthright, and he stole the family blessing, and when he deceived his father and what that did to that relationship, when he was drunk on love and liquor and he woke up with the wrong wife, when he made his own contribution to the family dysfunction. His brother Esau wanted to kill him, and it had been 20 years since he'd been back home. If you're a songwriter, you can get about 4 country albums from just Jacob's life and his story. He had a lot of scars and he had a lot of stories. But one of the reasons I think Jacob's story resonates with us is how open and honest the Bible is about his struggles, about his brokenness, about the scars that he experienced. And Jacob's story reminds us that God uses broken people, because it's the only kind of people he has to use. It's the only kind of people there are. And Jacob, in his brokenness and in his story, the hero of his story isn't Jacob. The hero of his story is God. It's the grace of God. It's the grace of God. It's a God who by his grace chases him down in the desert. And by his grace, he rescues him from Laban. It's his grace that rescues him from what he was experiencing there. It's his grace that wrestles him down and blesses him. It's his grace that reconciles relationships in his past. And it's his grace that gets him back home. The hero of Jacob's story is God and his grace. And that Hebrew word for grace shows up 17 times in the book of Genesis. And one third of those times is going to come from the passage that we're going to look at today. But just because grace is present doesn't mean that scars are absent. Because oftentimes those scars, when placed in the hands of the Redeemer, can become trophies of his grace. Now, there's an old saying, time heals all wounds. Have you ever heard that? That's not true. Like, time doesn't heal all wounds. Time heals all wounds that are treated. But some wounds get ignored, and some wounds get buried, and some wounds get hidden, and some wounds get shoved down deep. And time heals all wounds that are treated. And what God wants to do is he wants to treat those wounds in our stories, and he wants to bring healing for our past, and he wants to bring hope for our future. That's what we see in Jacob's story. And every Sunday, we have a prayer team that's down front at all of our campuses. And every once in a while, we're down front. Really, it happens quite frequently. Somebody will come down and somebody will say, I want to share something with you today that I've never shared with anyone. And I know when somebody does that, that somebody's about to experience healing. When somebody shares something that they've been holding on to and that they've never shared with anyone, they're about to experience healing, because the Bible says in James 5:16, it says, if we confess our sins to one another, that we will be healed. Now, Scripture tells us in 1 John 1:9 that if we confess our sins to God, that he is faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness, that he purifies us and cleanses us. What he's telling us there is, like, God power washes our soul. And so what this teaches us, if you want to be forgiven, confess your sin to God. But if you want to feel forgiven, confess your sins to others. Because we're only as sick as our secrets. We're only as sick as our secrets. And it's through confession to other people that we experience that healing of, we don't have to hold on. When I found out that birthmark had cancer cells, I didn't go, well, let's just see what happens. Now I was like, I want to get this out. I need help. And it's through confession. We confess our sins to God, we'll be forgiven. He promises he will forgive you. And through the cross, we have forgiveness of our sin, past, present, and future. So we receive forgiveness from God because of what Christ did on the cross. But when we confess our sins to one another, there is healing. One time in Mark 2, Jesus was having dinner with some broken people, the kind of people that can't hide their scars. And Jesus is around the table with them, and the religious leaders, they were offended because this prophet from God, the one who would claim to be the Messiah, he's sitting at the table with the kind of people that they couldn't believe that he would spend time with. And so they were, they were critical and they were complaining to the disciples. And Jesus overheard them complaining. And in verse 17, he says, on hearing this, Jesus said to them, it is not the healthy who need a doctor, but the sick. I've not come to call the righteous, but sinners. What Jesus is saying to these religious leaders is, you're sick too. Your sickness is pretending like you're righteous. He's like, I've come for you too, but we can't receive healing unless we confess our need. And Jesus is saying, I can't heal what you're pretending to cover up. Because if you want to experience healing, you have to bring your whole self to me, your brokenness. And Jesus wants to bring healing in our stories. And we see it in Genesis chapter 32. Jacob has an encounter with God, where God addresses the pain of his past. Genesis chapter 32 is what we're going to be looking at today, and it's the story of grace. Remember, Jacob left Laban's house. Laban was his uncle. If you'll remember, Laban was not a good man. Laban was an evil man. And he took advantage of Jacob. He took advantage of his daughters. And Jacob showed up at Laban's house with nothing. For 20 years he was there. All he had when he got there was a staff and a promise from God. And while he's there, God protects him and God provides for him. They say Nashville is a 10-year town. It's a 10-year town that it takes 10 years. It takes a decade as a creative to continue to work hard and to experience success. Well, Jacob is in Haran. He's there for 20 years. Haran is a 20-year town. And God has blessed him. In fact, while Jacob, he's 60 years old now when he's leaving Laban's house. He'd been there for 20 years. And he leaves with, he came with the staff and with some promises from God. But now he leaves with family. He leaves with children. He leaves with servants. He leaves with camels and donkeys and sheep and goats. What the text is telling us is that he's wealthy. And so Jacob has experienced God's blessing and God's favor, and he's leaving. And the last thing he does when leaving is he makes peace with Laban. I had never seen this detail in the text. The last thing he does is he shares a meal with Laban, and he leaves him, his father-in-law, he leaves him with forgiveness. I'd never seen this. So he forgives, he shares a meal with Laban, and he forgives him. And as I was thinking about this, I was like, how does Jacob forgive? I mean, Laban was the one, he was deceived him. He changed his wages like 10 times. He took advantage of Jacob. He changed the person he thought he was marrying. He gave him the other daughter and then made him work 7 more years for the daughter that he wanted to marry. Laban, all the wrong that Laban, how did Jacob forgive Laban? And I think beginning to understand that it's not just that Jacob had a Laban, but Jacob had also been a Laban. Because Jacob knew that he had wronged. It's not just that he had been wronged, but that he had wronged Esau. He had been a Laban. It's why Jesus taught us to pray, forgive us of our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. Because we've all been wronged and we've all wronged others. We've all been hurt and we've hurt others. We've all received scars, but we've also left scars in others. And Jesus said every day, pray like this, that we would forgive it. Because Jesus knows we need forgiveness and we need to give forgiveness like we need daily bread. Because every day we hurt others and we've been hurt by others. And Jesus wants to bring healing to our hearts. And Jacob didn't continue things on with Laban. He didn't strike up another business partnership. He didn't continue the relationship. In fact, I think this is the last time that he ever sees Laban. And he leaves him with forgiveness, and now he's on his way. And there's another relationship that needs to be restored. Another relationship that needs to be restored is with Esau. Pick up with me in verse 3. It says, and Jacob sent messengers ahead of him to his brother Esau in the land of Seir, the country of Edom. He instructed them, this is what you are to say to my lord Esau. Your servant Jacob says, I have been staying with Laban and have remained there until now. I have cattle and donkeys, sheep and goats, male and female servants. Now I'm sending this message to my lord that I may find favor in your eyes. And when the messenger returned to Jacob, they said, we went to your brother Esau, and now he's coming to meet you, and 400 men are with him. So Esau is coming toward Jacob. Do you see what Jacob sends a message. He sends the messengers to Esau to go say, hey, we got sheep, we got goats, we got all this stuff. What's Jacob doing here? Well, he's letting Esau know, I want to make things right. I know the way that I wronged you. I know the blessing that I took from you. I'm willing to give everything to you, so that the relationship, because the last thing Esau said was, I'm going to kill him when I see him. So Jacob's trying to figure out, how do I not die? So what he does is he divides everything into two groups, and one group he sends over here. And the reason two groups, he's like, Esau might get half of my stuff, but he's not going to get the other half. And so Jacob, it's self-preservation that Jacob is doing this. And he's at the same time, he calls Esau my lord, when the prophetic word that was received is that Esau would serve Jacob, not Jacob. You just see him in this moment. He's afraid. And he's sending all these things ahead saying, maybe, perhaps Esau will forgive. And he's not flexing about how much he has. He's just hoping that somehow Esau, he'll find favor in Esau's eyes. And he sends this message with the messengers. And the messenger, and we don't know how long this came back. You know the little bubble like on the phone where it's just like three little dots? You know how like when, so he sends out the message. This was like old school messenger with actual people. So he sends the message with some people to go here. And when they come back, they're like, hey, Esau's coming with 400 men. Now this is the size of a militia. And so Jacob's thinking, this is it. Like this is how it all goes down. This is how Jacob dies. And Jacob is afraid. So he divides it into these two groups. He sends them out. And then what's interesting, you read through chapter 32, and then Jacob prays. Well, I guess he does. This is the first time that Jacob prays in his story. The first time that he cries out to God. The first prayer that we have, the first record of prayer is right here when Jacob thinks that he's going to die. I started reading through this, and I mean, you read this prayer, it's a beautiful prayer. And I was thinking, you know, sometimes we can feel a sense of guilt and shame when we attempt to pray when things are bad. Like thinking that somehow that God's going, well, it's about time. It's about time you prayed. Where God shames us or offers up condemnation, but we know in Scripture that there is now, for those who are in Christ, there is no condemnation. Like, I don't mind if my daughters call me from college if they made a grade that they're really excited about or if they broke down on the side of the road. Like, I just want them to call me. Your Father in heaven loves you unconditionally. And we want prayer to be more of a first response than a last resort. But if it's a last resort, you need to know your Father in heaven, his heart is toward you. He welcomes your prayer. Whether the prayer is the spare tire or whether it's the steering wheel. Say, God, I want to trust you, and I want to come to you, and your Father welcomes you to come to him. And so Jacob turns to God as a last resort. He cries out to God, and we'll see God's response to his prayer. And he sends all his possessions across the river. In verse 20, he says, maybe Esau will see all this, and he'll receive me. And then Jacob spends the night at the brook of Jabbok. And what happens next is wild. It's one of the craziest, strangest, spectacular stories in Scripture. Look with me at verse 24. It says, so Jacob was left alone, and a man wrestled with him until daybreak. And when the man saw that he could not overpower him, he touched the socket of Jacob's hip so that his hip was wrenched as he wrestled with the man. And then the man said, let me go, for it is daybreak. But Jacob replied, I will not let you go unless you bless me. And the man asked him, what is your name? Jacob, he answered. And the man said, your name will no longer be Jacob, but Israel, because you have struggled with God and with humans and have overcome. And Jacob said, please tell me your name. But he replied, why do you ask my name? And then he blessed him there. So Jacob called the place Peniel, saying, it is because I saw God face to face, and yet my life was spared. The sun rose above him as he passed Peniel, and he was limping because of his hip. Now, who is Jacob wrestling? Well, the most common interpretation, and based on what Jacob said, he's wrestling with God. He has a wrestling match, little Jesus jiu-jitsu. Yeah, he's wrestling with God. He is wrestling with God, and God wrestles him down in that moment, and there's this wrestling match going on, and Jacob is wrestling with God, but God could destroy Jacob. And it's like when I would wrestle with my boys when they were little, and you know, they would think I was giving it everything I had, but really I was just making them think that I was giving it everything I had. And so God is wrestling with Jacob through the night. Now Durham is 225. I don't wrestle with him anymore, but when he was little, I would wrestle with him. And there's this wrestling match that's going on between Jacob and God, and Jacob says, I'm not going to let go of you unless you bless me. Like, I'm going to hold on, and I'm going to wrestle with you until you bless me. Now, look with me. What question does God ask? God says, what is your name? Why did God ask that question, what is your name? Because that's the question that his father Isaac asked when Jacob deceived him. and said he was Esau. God wanted to heal Jacob, but in order to heal him, he had to take him back to the place of his greatest regret. He had to take him back to the place that he wanted to conceal the most. Because the thing that we want to conceal the most is the place that we need to heal the most. And it was through that confession, my name's Jacob, I'm the heel grabber. It was through confessing his own sin and his own brokenness that Jacob could receive the healing that God, the blessing that God longed to give him. Because God's saying, Jacob, I can't bless somebody you're pretending to be. So I want you to bring the real you to me. It's the same way Jesus, after Peter denied him three times, Jesus made a charcoal fire by the beach. The resurrected Christ, the resurrected Jesus, made a charcoal fire. There's only two places in the text that the charcoal fire is mentioned. One is the place where Peter denied him three times. Jesus recreated the same scene, brought Peter back and asks him three times, do you love me? Why does he ask him three times next to the, but so that Peter would, that he would smell that fire, not to condemn him, but to reveal to Peter, I want to address the thing that you're trying to conceal so that I can bring healing to your heart. I want to treat the wound of your heart. I want to bring healing to your heart because I've got more for you, Peter. God's saying, Jacob, I have more for you, but you have to be honest about your past, about your brokenness. I want to bring healing. I want to bless you. And so God brought him back to that moment so that he would be honest. There's a great author, Dietrich Bonhoeffer, he wrote a book called Life Together, and in it he says, you are a sinner, a great desperate sinner. Now come as the sinner that you are to God who loves you. He wants you as you are. He does not want anything from you, a sacrifice, a work. He wants you alone. That's what God wants. He wants you alone. And God has Jacob alone. Maybe for the first time in a long time, alone before him. And Jacob receives God's blessing. And what does he receive? He receives a new name. God says, your name is Israel now, which means one who contends, one who wrestles, one who struggles with God and overcomes and prevails. God gives him a new name and he gives him a limp. And in chapter 33, the sun is coming up and he sees Esau coming toward him. And he's covered in dirt. And he's walking with a limp. It's hard to look tough when you're limping. And so Jacob is covered in dirt. He's been wrestling with God all night. And he walks toward Esau and all he's got is covered in dirt, walking with a limp, holding on to his staff. In verse 4, but Esau ran to meet Jacob and embraced him. He threw his arms around his neck and he kissed him. And they wept. Phew. This is grace. This is mercy. This is forgiveness. Jacob knew in that moment he deserved death. Esau said he was going to kill him, but Esau wraps him up. He embraces him. They weep together. I want you to think with me. Where is another place in Scripture where someone was broken and someone had made decisions that they weren't real proud of, and then they received grace. They received an embrace. They received tears. They received rejoicing. Lights on the dashboard should be going off for Luke chapter 15 when Jesus tells the story of the prodigal son. Of the prodigal son who returns home and the father embraces and the father weeps and the father rejoices that they've come back home. So when Jesus told this story to the Pharisees, he told this story to the Pharisees and to sinners in Luke chapter 15, they would have thought, Esau. They would have thought, this is what happens when there's reunion. This is what reunion looks like. And this is how we experience revival. Communion with God and reunion with others. Communion with God and reunion with others. It's communion with God. It's wrestling with God. It's being honest about our past. It's finding healing for our hearts. It's confessing our failures and our struggles and bringing our scars to him and experiencing his healing touch. It's offering our wounds to him because Jesus, who is the only righteous one, he has wounds too. He has wounds too, and he wrestled with God. The suffering servant wrestled with God in the garden in prayer before the cross. He wrestled with God on the cross. He laid down his life and was raised again so that we would overcome. And Jesus' scars tell the story of our forgiveness. Jesus' scars tell the better story of that there is healing and that there is wholeness for us. His scars are trophies of grace. And now our greatest regrets don't get the final word. And we receive a new name. Chosen. Accepted. Forgiven. Beloved. Children of God. We receive a new name. We're made brand new. This is the reality of what the scars of Christ have purchased for us, so that we can be reconciled with God. And because we've been reconciled with God, we get to participate in a ministry of reconciliation with others. Because there are people that we've wronged. There are people who carry scars because of decisions that we've made. And so we can take that ministry of reconciliation to others. And it's praying and it's asking, God, who do I need to be reconciled with? And it's going and having a conversation. It may just be like, help me. Help me have a conversation. Saying something like, I'm sorry. Things are a mess. And it's complicated. I don't even know where to begin. But let's start here. I know that I've hurt you. I know that I've wounded you. And I don't even know all the ways. Would you share that with me? Because I want to make things right. I'm going to start by listening. And then listen. And they might respond like Esau. Or they may respond like Laban. But it's not your responsibility how they respond. Your responsibility is obedience. And the scripture says, insofar as it depends on you, live at peace with everyone. And the reason it says, insofar as it depends on you, is there's a limit to what we can do. But there's not a limit to what God can do. But healing takes time. And we don't get to set the schedule. We have to trust God for that. But it's asking God, what part do you have for me? Because what revival looks like is communion with God. And here's why Jacob had to wrestle it down with God before he encountered Esau. Because his identity was not in Esau's response. His identity, his new identity was found in Christ. And God gives him a new name. I want you to think about this. He gives him a new name and he gives him a limp. The thing about a new name and the thing about a limp, when you have a limp, what's the first question that people ask? What happened? Well, there's a story. When you get a new name and somebody's like, hey, Jacob, what's up? He's like, well, my name's not Jacob anymore. Like, what's your name? My name is Israel. Why? There's a story. See, God set Jacob up to tell his story. And God has set you up to tell your story too. A story of grace, a story of forgiveness, a story of redemption. A story of communion and reunion. When you've experienced healing, you have a story to tell. And it may just be in your story that other people find healing and hope as well. God wants to give you a better story. And so it starts with acknowledging the scars of what we've experienced and bringing those scars to him, offering those scars to him. Say, God, I need your healing. It's through confessing our own brokenness and confessing our sin and maybe the things that have happened to us or the things we've done to others is confessing those things to God. And then it's found in confessing those things to others. Communion. And reunion. That's what revival looks like. Let me tell you about a day. one day, all of us who are in Christ, who have put our trust in Jesus and received forgiveness, and if you've never had that experience, you can have that experience today. But we will be with him in heaven. I heard an old preacher say one time, he said, do you know the only man-made things in heaven? Do you know what the only man-made things in heaven will be? You ever heard this? The only man-made things in heaven will be the scars in Jesus' hands and feet and side. In heaven, Jesus will be the only one with scars. And he will wipe every tear from every eye. And he will heal every heart. And everything will be as it should be. But until that day, you need to know that it's by his scars that we find healing. And we can begin to experience that healing today so that we can tell a better story and give him all the glory. Let me lead you in prayer together. Father, thank you. Thank you for your grace. Thank you for your mercy. Thank you that you meet us here. And today, if you have never received the forgiveness of God through for what Christ has done for you on the cross, forgiveness for your past and your present and your future sin, if you want that communion with God, it can happen in a moment. It's by grace through faith. And it can start with a prayer like this. I'll just lead you in a prayer and you can just whisper it if that's what you want. If you want to be free, just pray something like this. Father, thank you for loving me. Thank you for sending your son Jesus to die on the cross for my sin. I receive your grace. I receive your mercy. I receive your love. I give my life to you. I receive the new name today. Child, beloved, forgiven. I want to walk with you here on earth and spend forever with you in heaven. Thank you for saving me. Father, I pray for all those who made that their prayer. Would you give them the courage and the boldness to let somebody know, to share that with a friend or with our prayer team down front after service? And then God, I pray for healing today. I pray that today would be the beginning of deeper healing, maybe for those who have walked with you for a long time but are carrying secrets. God, you would give the courage and the grace to share. That today would be the beginning of you treating something and bringing healing so that there can be wholeness, so that there can be freedom. God, I pray that as a church, that we would be known as a people who work toward reconciliation. That we would be known as a church that goes after reconciliation, that we've experienced reconciliation with the Holy God through Christ, and that we pursue reconciliation with others. And God, although we may be clumsy, and although we may struggle, and although we may stumble, may that be what we work toward. So Jesus, we would look like you. And then God, I pray that you would help us tell the stories of how our scars have become trophies of your grace. This in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We're going to continue with a song that reminds us that God, through his redemption, is at work in every situation, and he's given us a better story to tell.
The hour is dark, and
it's hard to see what you are doing here in the ruins and where this will lead. Oh, but I know that down through the years, I'll look back on this moment and see your hand on it and know you were here. And I'll testify of the battles you've won, how you were my portion when there wasn't enough.
Thank you.
And I'll testify of the seas that we cross, the waters you parted, the waves that I walked. Oh, 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 my God did not fail. Oh, 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 it's the story I'll tell. I'm singing. Believing is hard when options are few, when I can't see what you're doing. I know that you're proving you're the God who comes through. I'll see your hand on it and know you were here. And I'll testify of the battles you've won. I'll testify the way with my portion when there wasn't enough. And I'll testify of the seas that the waters you parted, the waves that I
know, two questions just come to mind this morning. Have you received your new name yet? Maybe some of you in here prayed that prayer with Pastor Kevin for the very first time. And you have found Jesus. And we would love nothing more than to come alongside you and just pray with you and help you understand what it looks like to follow him now. And then the second question is, do you have scars that you're holding on to that you've just been afraid to reveal? Same way, our prayer team is down front each and every Sunday just to tell you you're not alone. That we'll step in the gap with you, that we'll pray for you to help just receive that coming home to Jesus, that full hug, that embrace, just like the prodigal. And so this morning, wherever you find yourself, we would love to walk with you through that. Our prayer team's going to be right down front here at the end. Keep in mind, too, every Tuesday at 11 o'clock, we pray right here for an hour, 11 to 12 every Tuesday. Everyone is invited. Everyone is welcome in those moments as well. And I just want to encourage you, next week we'll be celebrating Mother's Day here and at all of our campuses. Make sure you are back and you are celebrating your mamas next Sunday. So join us here. Bring a friend. We love you guys so much. Thank you for being here today, and we'll see you back here next Sunday.